That's right. Now let's take Ireland for an example, Mohammed. $1 billion of the debt that they've signed on to, and they've signed on to almost 900 and change billion on their debt side. The most recent tranche of insanity that paid out counterparties that was borrowed by Ireland was borrowed at an average of almost 6%. So let's do that on the cost of just $1 billion of the 85 or 90 that they got. $1 billion, that's $600 million every single year, the first year, $600 million in interest alone that they have to pay on the money that they got, they were forced to borrow to cover counterparty risk. Because none of that money, by the way, that was borrowed by the Irish is staying in Ireland. That's all going to French banks and German banks and the City of London. So now that they're on the hook for the $600 million in interest, plus they still have the principal. So if they, let's say they take down the principal by $400 million that first year. So the next year they owe $595 million in interest. And so by the end of the loan, of the 20-year loan or 15-year loan, they've paid back tens of billions of money, of interest money, that could have gone to their public, that they never saw benefit of, that these vultures have sucked out of their public purse. But more important than that is that there's a compounding effect to the problems of borrowing money when you don't have the ability to pay, because at some point in the future, the Irish, the poor Irish, are going to have to restructure again and get further in debt. So what they're doing is they're indebting their children and their grandchildren out into infinitum. They are, for all intents and purposes, absolutely screwed 100% forever. Now, the British have been paying off an interest loan since 1690-something, if I'm not mistaken. It is a loan that can never be repaid. Am I correct in saying that in the founding of the Bank of England?
Yeah, well, exactly, Dan. It's just over 310 years, something like that, that the first loan was made. I believe it was for a term of 5 or 7 years originally, and we're still kind of stuck with it. There was a small period where the national debt had been paid off in the middle of all those centuries, so if any pedantic people out there want to correct us, I'll just get that one in. There was a short period, but, you know, the bankers weren't happy with that. The Dutch bankers that were behind Cromwell were behind this loan system, and they just got it back on, and we've never got rid of it since. So with the exception of a short period, over 300 years, we've been indebted as a nation, either through our monarchy or through our government, to foreign thrones upon which bankers sit, and they've absolutely caned us and milked us for centuries.
Well, let's talk a little bit about who these people are for the public. We brought this subject up at least 100 files on the French Connection, and we know who they are. But let's talk a little bit about history here, so these people have an idea that are new to this, because a lot of people don't realize there are 1,100 hours of audio files on the French Connection, and at least 150 of those hours are between you and I talking mostly finance and money. But here's the thing: we've got the Cromwell boys being sponsored back into Britain when they came in with William of Orange and the rest of it. And the Irish will remember that Cromwell was the guy that would really put a terrible beating on their country when he held sway. And of course they reinstituted a monarchy that was not the original Tudor reign. And of course now we have infiltration of Jewish interests from the Battenberg line and other lines. And we also have Rothschild and his sisters over the generations marrying into the peerages. So a lot of these names like Pembroke and stuff are actually Jewish families. But the point I'm trying to make here is, are these people Sabbatean Jews extensively or ostensibly, or are they Sephardic in some of them? Because a lot of the Sephardi moved up to the Dutch region, to Holland, after they were jettisoned by Isabella and Ferdinand. Or is it a mix of these two? Because we know that there are families like the Honigs and like the Warburgs and like Schiff and like Oppenheimer and all of these people in counting houses and banking houses over time, and Rothschild, of course. But are there ties to both Sephardi and to Ashkenazim or the Sabbateans? And what kind of mix do we have in the upper reaches of this conspiracy?
Well, the thing to remember is that when it comes to money and business, whatever bad blood and feelings there are between Ashkenazi and Sephardi, the Jews have, as a community, been very good at burying the hatchet when it comes down to them making money and doing business. So they do have a history of commercial activities together. They do not, and certainly up to the end of the Victorian ages, do not have a history of intermarriage or shared worship. And in fact, I gave a quote on one of the shows not that long ago, Darrell, from one of the biographies of the Rothschild family, where it talks about the fact that the Rothschilds attended an Ashkenazi synagogue in the East End of London, and another family that they were doing business with, I believe that it may have been the Sassoon family, attended the Sephardi synagogue in another part of East London, and that these two groups were actually prohibited by the rabbis of each synagogue from praying behind and joining the services of the other synagogues, and from intermarriage. So they tended to shy away from marriage quite a lot, but they and they kept themselves as Ashkenazi and Sephardi. But when it comes to business activities, you will find that they did mutually support each other.
Well, and we also know that many of the Jewish bankers that were predominant in the Aegean region of Italy, of course, and even, you know, in Siena, for that matter, on the other coast, we have a lot of people in Venice, and the Venice bankers and the Florence bankers that came into France, migrated with the Medici and the rest in the Middle Ages and so forth. And these banking families that Shakespeare wrote about with the Shylock and the rest, these banking families were predominantly Sephardi.
That's correct, and of course they'd done the equivalent of a Vatican II in their day. Somewhere in the 12th century, the Jews of Lombardy and the ones who were in other parts of Italy actually went and lobbied the Vatican for a long time to legalize their ability to use usury inside the Catholic lands, because it was in fact prohibited. And it was at some point in the 12th century that the Vatican invented the concept of purgatory. And if you look into religious history now, you'll find that purgatory was invented by the Vatican as a place where Christians who dealt in usury would go for a period of time before being allowed to enter paradise. That then resulted in the creation of the first trade bills of exchange coming out from the Lombardy area, starting to finance usurious trade throughout Europe. And as you quite rightly pointed out, by two centuries that had made its way up into other parts of Europe, where there were more Protestant movements, and the Protestant movement found themselves at odds with the way in which these Jews were behaving, and it resulted in of course, the great Shakespeare himself writing The Merchant of Venice, talking about Protestant Christians coming across a Jew in their midst who was financing a trade bill, lending money on the basis of The Merchant of Venice's ship coming in. In fact, his ship was out at sea, there was stormy weather, he had to honour some payments, and his goods were at sea, so ordinarily he would have borrowed interest free from Christians, and the people that he normally would borrow from all found themselves in a predicament, and he had to turn to Shylock the Jew. What's interesting about all of that story, of course, Darrell, is the culture of the time, and what's difficult for people to understand now is how alien the idea of usury was, even in commercial transactions among Christians 500-600 years ago. It was completely and utterly something that was socially abhorrent, and now it's just, you know, we stand by and watch the bigger nations and wealthy nations of the world use the interest trick to strip poorer nations of their natural resources and everything that they've got and rip them off royal. But back then it was a complete anathema. That's how much these people have changed our European and Western culture.
Well, we also know that there was a very bizarre moral code or lack of morals in the northern Jewish group that we call them Frankists, because there was a movement of these people under Jacob Frank, but preceding him was Sabbatai Zevi or Sabbatai C, who was the man who claimed himself to be the Messiah of the Jews, and he was rejected by the Sephardic Jewish controllers in Jerusalem as that, and they sent him packing, saying that we don't sign on to your claim. But his followers within Ashkenazi circles did, by and large, accept him in many ways. But even he was not fully accepted. And the northern Jews in Poland and in the Ukraine and in Latvia and Estonia, and of course there were little communities or ghetto communities of Jews throughout that area. Many of these communities were not on board with his brand of Judaism. His brand of Judaism was quite bizarre, was it not?
It was indeed, Dan. And actually, to understand the size of his movement, he had more than a million followers at the back end of the 17th century. I mean, that's just, by today's standards, that's hundreds of millions. I mean, he did have a huge following in his day. And it was very bizarre, according to the history books. It said that many tens of thousands of people actually experienced dreams where they saw his face in the dream, and in those dreams that he was the Messiah. So there's a very sort of strange element to it. He announced himself as Messiah, stood as Messiah, and what he did was he said to the Jews who followed him, which ran into, as I say, more than a million in a day, Ashkenazi and Sephardi, although many Sephardi rejected him, some did follow him. The Ashkenazi followed him very easily. But what he said was, if you believe I am the Messiah, he said, then you will believe that I am the fulfillment of the law. And I tell you that as Messiah from today forwards, the law does not exist. And that you must abandon the law, and the law was only here for the ignorant time of mankind, and you are my followers, the enlightened people, and you don't need to live under the curse of the law anymore. This was basically what his spiel was. And he actually got the Jews who followed him to burn the books, the Torah and the Talmud, and he told them, from this day forward you only need the Zohar. And they became nicknamed at that time by the other parts of the Jewish community the Zoharites, because they abandoned Torah and Talmud and all of the laws. He was then followed by his vicars or his caliphs, whatever you want to call them, one of whom was Frank, Jacob Frank. And Jacob Frank went round and proselytized into Germany, and he actually converted the Moses Amschel Bauer, as he was known at the time. He converted him to Zoharite belief, and that's why he adopted the name Rothschild, and he became a financial supporter of Frank. One of the reasons that the mainstream Sephardi and Orthodox Ashkenazi, for that matter, strong Torah believers rejected him, was that Frank actually made very bizarre requests on his followers. He demanded of them that they prove that they believed he is the current incarnation of the Messiah. And that proof was, he demanded that they commit acts of incest, that they would swap their wives, or sleep with their mothers, or their sisters, or their daughters. That they would commit these acts because they understood that they were no longer prohibited acts. And he got them to do it in public orgies as well now. And this is why...
Don't they still possess, don't they still practice the night of anything goes? They have one night a year where they just, you know, they just, the lights go out and the crap hits the fan, and these people are just a mess of hairy-backed sickos and naked...
There is a night even like that, and that is well-known among the Donne Jews, who were very strong Zohorites in the Jewish area. Because of that practice, for many years, the Israeli state would not allow them the right of return and would not accept them as Jews because they said, you don't know who your mothers are. But actually, in the past couple of decades, there's been a reversal on that, because they realized how valuable these people are as spies, and they also said, okay, maybe your mother was your sister, but she was still Jewish, so we will accept you as bastard and other types of unlawful offspring of Jewish women, because you only slept with Jewish women, even if the lights were off and you don't know which ones they were.
And now, there were certain terms that I've used on podcasts talking about, it's come into popular culture, and through film and through books and through shared stories, the idea of being bohemian. Now, in the German, southern German regions of Bavaria and so forth, and areas of Bohemia, there were certain communities of Frankists that were involved in these kinds of activities, and they called these people avant-garde thinkers or avant-garde people, and they called them New Bohemians. And that came into the culture as being somebody who's willing to take risks of all certain types, taking a chance to be on the edge of morality, if you will. And of course, you know, that the first forays into pornography and the rest of it in Western culture that was going against Christian doctrine and Christian belief systems came from these Bohemians, these New Bohemians. And that kind of now is in the lexicon as kind of they try to portray that as a positive element. You often hear it in relation to artists. Oh, he's very Bohemian, or that area of the city, you know, where the nightclubs are. Oh, that's a very Bohemian area. Well, it has a sterilized sound to it, but it was anything but that, and it represented something quite different. Am I right?
Well, they try to say that, you know, the Age of Enlightenment and the reformers and the Great Reformation that came, that all of these positive cultural art things, that these people basically piggybacked on this stuff by trying to show themselves as people who were enlightened, which of course, you know, brings us back to this idea of their secret groups calling themselves Illuminati, the enlightened. They tried to show themselves as people who were enlightened and progressive, which is of course what Sabbatai Zevi had said, that you have left the darkness of the law because you've accepted me as the Messiah. You are the new enlightened people. You don't live under the curse of the law. What the Zohar says is that there is the left and right hand of God. They are the white and the black hand of God. And that if you do evil in the world, it's no longer a sin. You are simply working the black hand of God, the left hand of God. And if you do good in the world, it's the same thing. If you do good, if you give in charity, kill a child, it's equal in moral value, as long as your intention is correct. And they try to put themselves forward as, you know, progressive thinkers. They always had this mask of what they really are beneath that, which again was something that was taught them by Zevi, Darrell. Sabbatai Zevi said, you are allowed to outwardly profess any belief you want. You can say you're a Christian, you can say you're a Jew, you can say you're a Muslim, you can say you're a Buddhist, just so long as, in your heart, you are truly a Zohorite. You truly believe in me. You're allowed to profess any external religion as long as you can advance the cause.
Now, in the early part of the 20th century, when, of course, these people fomented the First World War so that they could rejig the entire landscape of Europe. There were people in the northern parts of Europe who were not what we call today Zionists, because Zionism was given birth to by leadership from the Zoharitis community, and of course add-ons from Sevi and then Frank and the rest. And these communities were not on board. They were Orthodox Jews. A lot of them were Ashkenazim. They had rejected this Zoharitis teachings, and they were Torah and Talmudic. Now the Talmud has enough of its own sickness that you don't need to go very far within the reading of the Talmud to find all kinds of bizarre and sick the descriptions of how you treat others, and especially non-Jews. When you get to the Zohar, it becomes like somebody's on LSD reading this stuff. But the point of the matter is that they had opposition within their own Jewish communities. They had almost like two separate groups. Many of them, from the same ethnic background. They had the light-skinned, blue-eyed, Northern European or Khazarian look to them, but they were not on the same page. And by World War II, they found a way to get around that, didn't they? They said, okay, we'll get the ones that want to sign on to this idea to migrate, and the ones that don't, we're going to shove you in a work camp. And we're going to clear up our whole problem and get ourselves established in a place where we can do our bidding and our dirty work from a place that has immunity from the world's prosecution, which is, of course, Israel. They got Rothschild to support it financially. And then there you go. Now we've got the hole-in-the-wall crime central called Israel, and we got rid of our opposition that didn't want this to happen. We got rid of them by having them work and then ultimately starve to death in German work camps, and we killed two birds with one stone. And how I know that? The transfer agreement tells us this. The fact that there are coins with the swastika on one side and the Star of David on the other. The fact that there were German ships ferrying tons of material and food and personnel and people, Jewish people, out of Northern Europe into the Palestine region back in the early 30s, doing this stuff together at the urgings of the Nazi Party. So we know that this happened, Mohammed.
We do indeed. I mean, one of the important things there was Isaac Grunbaum, Yitzhak Grunbaum.
Yes.
Who was the head of the Jewish Agency's Rescue Committee, who, when he was approached by rabbis of the Neturei Charter, who'd managed to strike a deal with Nazis to get Jews out to New York, he said, "If you are asking me for money," this was what he replied to Rabbi Michael Bar Weismandel, he said, "If you're asking me for money to send Jews to anywhere other than Palestine, the answer is no. I repeat, no."
That's right. And so he sealed their fate in a work camp. And these people, of course, went in and started building, helmets and bullets and armaments and shells and the rest of it. But then from there we go on to other things. But the fact of the matter is, now where we are today is that same group, after the rejigging of the Second World War, was firmly ensconced in the United States leadership and hierarchy. They did it through intimidation, through extortion, through murder, through organized crime. They were very instrumental in the prohibition, which gave up huge amounts of money and capital to their network. The Brofman family up in Canada, shipping down Seagram's whiskey into the United States, made fortunes, absolute fortunes, and they did it in conjunction with a lot of non-Jews, including the Kennedy family and many others. But ultimately, they were at the top of that pyramid again, making big money, as they are in the drug trade today. And they were skimming and making huge sums of money on the Americans and just strengthening their stranglehold over the American public. Is that fair to say? Is there anything you can add to that?
Well, of course, Darryl, it's always been part of their modus operandi to use masks. And those masks can be completely separate looking people, you know. They're very keen on using Gentiles to front up their organisations and their trusts and things like that, so that they don't appear to be exercising any control or have any involvement in particular areas. This is something which they've also done for centuries and can easily be demonstrated, whether it was Rothschild backing Cecil Rhodes, Rhodes eventually wandering off, whether it was them backing Stalin, whether it was them backing Marx, whether it was them backing Hitler, whether it was them backing even Napoleon. At different points in time, they've put money behind all sorts of people, be they politicians, be they generals and men of war, be they bankers and businessmen. They've used them all to front their operations and front their money at different times, so as to appear to be, reasonably well off, but not involved in any of this nonsense which is going on in France or in the Americas or Europe, always distancing themselves so that the blame's not there. We're very fortunate at the French Connection to have, as you've come across, Darryl, so many important and rare books.
Yep, yep.
Where people had access to things that were going on at the time or close to the time, managed to document those things.
That's
all
right.
All of those books are in a single place.
Yep.
The evidence, when taken as a collective set of books, is overwhelming.
Yes.
Each book in itself is a strong argument,
yep.
But together it's overwhelming, and the fact of the matter is that they have a modus operandi that's worked for centuries. It doesn't work now because the internet has shone a light on their part of the world which has made them feel very uncomfortable, but they have got away with it for centuries.
Well, now you can even go back and talk about the funding of the Jacobins, and much of that funding was not only into the French Republic, but the monies that were used to foment the overthrow or the rebellion against the Catholic Church through the Jacobins, and in what they called in Scotland the Jacobites, was French money that was not French money, it was Jewish money. Now, we also see the same thing with Calvin. Many people have done research now and found out that Mr. Calvin's name was actually Cohen. And of course,
this is another thing which they've often done also, Darryl, which is change their names when it suits them. So they have actually had their own people on the ground involved in all sorts of enterprises, but with different names.
Well, it's like John Kerry, and of course John Kerry, his family is the Kahn family, and now Kahn Loeb comes to mind, and then you can't go very far, and then you hear the names Dominique Strauss-Kahn, and these are all family relations, and there's no doubt that the branches of the Kerry family, his name is Irish, and of course he's a politician in an Irish state of Massachusetts, and of course as a Kahn, he probably wouldn't have gone very far at all, but they go as far as setting up his background for him. They put him on a gunboat and then set up a story that he becomes a hero. But then when you dig under the surface of the story, people of the time that were there present during the so-called heroic deeds of this guy say, wait a minute, this guy didn't act heroically at all. But we had control over the storytelling when it got back to him, so of course he gets elected to Senate, he takes on the role of leadership in a lot of areas, and bing, bang, boom, and presto, change-o, this guy is making and writing policy. And the same thing is true of Dominique Strauss-Kahn over here, and it goes on and on. Or the retelling of the Sarkozy history, where Mr. Sarkozy's father, blah blah blah, is this royal from Hungary, and he comes in as a poor waif from from exile, and blah blah blah, and rises from the ashes and becomes this powerful politician. But they don't tell you that his father and his grandfather that raised him, was a direct descendant of one of the rabbis of Salonika, Greece, that overthrew the Ottomans. So you all you do is have to look beyond, a little bit beyond, the Schickengruber family and the Hitler family, where they bulldozed an entire cemetery, but Adolf Hitler's sister was head of a Jewish agency in Austria. And they don't put non-Jews in charge of an agency of Jewish control.
Nope. If it's a Jewish organization, you can guarantee it's headed up by Jews every time.
Well, then how does, you know, how does Adolf Hitler's sister be involved in a Jewish agency that's being run out of, you know, and how does a lowly corporal with limited skills and a gift of gab rise up to be an Adolf Hitler without the proper funding? And of course, his Nazi party, they've never been able to find out where the big money came from in the early 30s. And of course, a lot of the people around him, and the Speers, and the different Eichmanns, and all the rest of it, and his general staff were riddled with very powerful, very connected Jews. So, you know, you go on and on in this history, and of course, a lot of this stuff has been buried in books that I was fortunate enough to come across. And I don't claim the authorship of any of these things. What I do claim is that I was very opportune. I came in at the right time, and people heard the sincerity in my presentation and offered up to me books that had been out of print. And you mentioned yourself, Muhammad, that some of the books I put on my site you had only heard about.
I'd seen them as references in other works, but I'd never been able to gain access to the books. They were almost mythical, certainly legendary, 20 years ago.
Yep. And they came out, and now many of them have been hived off of my site. No credit given, but that's okay. I don't know where some of them came from, so I didn't credit the sources either on some of these things. But, you know, people like Ezra Pound, who did his homework, did come across a lot of this stuff, and he did put this stuff in there. And then, of course, Eustace comes along and parlays his research through the Library of Congress, which many of these books now you can't find even in the Library of Congress. They've been delisted. That Eustace found back in the 1950s and 60s. And of course, now we do have a chronology. We do have a strong history of this stuff. But they've always used finance as the vehicle to the power. And the finance that they've used and the usury they've inflicted has only been a vehicle for them. They don't hang their hat on the money. They hang their hat on what the money gives them in power. And that has to be understood. And see, people think that this financial system's failure will destroy the upper elites, but they've used this system to buy up everything. So now, you know, 70% of the water systems in America are in U.S. Filter's hands, but U.S. Filter is a Veolia company. And you know, and you start going down the list of things they own. E.ON, the old nationalized electric grid in Italy, is now owned by Electricité de France, which is now a private company sold off pennies on the franc, centimes on the franc to this conglomerate that is controlled through trust. Now, it's getting to the next part of this, and this is kind of an overview of everything. About 1991, I was talking with some academics about, and this was before I knew any of this stuff, Muhammad, there was a show on about the trust arrangements that the Warburgs had up in Sweden and Germany and in Northern Europe, where they talked about the Warburgs on paper having only several million in value, several million dollars worth of money on the books of their family fortune. But what they talked about was how much these people controlled. And what they controlled was at the time in the 100 billion area. Now it's in the trillions. But so I would like to know from you how these blind trusts and these agreements, these trusts that give them the power that's clandestine. That's why you never see a Warburg on the Forbes 100 list. That's why you never see a Rothschild on there, or an Oppenheimer on there, or a Koenig on there, or a Brofman on there. Because they have been smart enough through their manipulation of the legal system to set up where they control, but they're not fingered with the ownership.
Absolutely. I'll give a good example of that. We have the Duke of Westminster, who is the richest landowner in the UK, as a single private. Obviously the Queen is the number one, really, but in terms of landowner, he's ranked as number one. And somebody actually did a map of London, central London, Chelsea, Park Lane, Mayfair, Hyde Park, all these areas that he technically owns the freehold on. And the TV crew went up there to interview him about this and say, look, you know, you own it. This was in 1986-87, £5 billion worth of freehold in central London, which must be 50, 60, 70 billion now, you know, just tremendous amount of freehold. So he said, I don't really consider myself to be the owner. He said, the land is owned in a trust, and I consider myself just the caretaker of that trust. So if you were to sue him, none of those assets are in his name. When he dies, the trust is set up in such a way that his descendants will also be beneficiaries of the trust. But they don't own the assets, so you can't sue them for it. There's no inheritance tax because they don't inherit it. There's no use tax because all of the money, the rents that these freeholds and the leases that these things pay, all go into the trust. And of course, the trust is a not-for-profit organisation. So all of this money and this rent is going in there. These trusts are entrenched, certainly in British law. We've got the concept now of something being entrenched. Entrenched means that it's such an old and ancient precedent, 400, 500, 600-year-old precedent in English law. It's so old that no judge and not even the government can enact a law to overturn it. And the laws of trust are known as entrenched laws in the UK. So this means that the government is not actually empowered to change any laws and change the status quo of these trusts. So they are absolutely bulletproof. If you've got a 200, 300-year-old trust, it absolutely cannot be attacked even by the government.
Now, it actually has taken on a different, morphed into different power bases where they go supranational. The Warbricks, for example, have holdings within Sweden and within Denmark and within Germany, and you know, Hamburg used to be a major center for Warburg money. Of course, Max Warburg sat out the war all the way till 1944 until they decided they were going to bomb, and the guy got out a few weeks beforehand. So the truth of the matter is that the trust agreements they have actually are international holdings that go under the color of this trust law. But in America, we've used even other vehicles. Trust law is the same structure as in Britain and in the United States, and they clandestinely control assets through these trusts, but they also do it through the structure of foundations. And the foundations they control are also tax-free, but they're also controlled by, at the top, by these individuals, Ford or Carnegie Mellon or the rest of it, and they have actually more specific uses, where they actually, like the Carnegie Mellon Trust, goes after policy within education, which always goes to benefit their story, their Holocaust story, or their situation, or their new way of dumbing down the public, but it's again, bulletproof and tax-free. But at the top of these trusts, you're seeing the same people circulate around. Now, they claim to have boards of directors and the rest of this stuff, but there is still a final arbiter of policy within all of these organizations, and that is this group at the very top. Am I correct in making those statements in a broad sense?
Indeed. I mean, one of the reasons that they have these different vehicles, whether it's a trust, a foundation, or whatever, is that they've got the best tax lawyers and trust lawyers that money can buy, who advise them on what structures will give them what they need in the different jurisdictions, and therefore they've incorporated whatever's required in the States or in Scandinavia or the Netherlands or Germany or the UK or France or Switzerland. These people have advised them on how they can get into a situation where A, it's bulletproof, which is the first thing, nobody's going to be able to mess about with it, and B, it meets whatever their requirements are. You can be certain that their names do not appear anywhere in the management of these trusts or foundations or institutes or whatever they formed. They are never on the controlling side of this, but they are the beneficiaries, which means that the controllers have to act to the good of the beneficiary. If you're paid as a director of a trust to work on that trust in the UK, you will be expected to produce the best possible results for the trust, and that trust says that this person is the beneficiary, which means that you have to act in that person's best interests at all times in order to claim your salary. Otherwise the beneficiary can get you sacked, because he can turn around and complain to the rest of the board, this person isn't acting in the best interests of the trust. So ultimately the beneficiary's got the power to be able to sack them in terms of complaining against their job, but these guys get paid such good salaries, Darryl, they get themselves $250,000, $500,000 a year as a trustee, why mess it up? Just do the right thing for Mr. Rothschild or Mr. Warburg or whomever. Just do whatever it is that they want. Make this trust operate for them in the best possible way. Make it look hands off, arm's length, because it's supposed to be. But you get your salary.
Well, we see how the growth of this actually can start out anti-Zionist Jew. In relation to this, you see how Henry Ford knew darn well that the people controlling the flow of international capital and the things that his business needed to be the player it was in the early part of the 20th century. And then all of a sudden, a couple of generations go by, they put a couple of trusts together, and the Ford Foundation comes out of it, and it's controlled by Jewish interests. We see that with Kaiser, Henry J. Kaiser, the guy that built all of the ships and did all of the aircraft and investing for all these other things, Henry J. Kaiser. Now we have the Kaiser Trust and the Kaiser Foundation and Kaiser Permanente Healthcare and all the rest of this. We see this repeatedly, but we also see these people positioning themselves to take over from non-Jews the agreements and wealth that they might have built. You can see it with the richest, best paid entertainer in the history of the world having gone to his grave in debt. And that is, of course, Michael Jackson. This man was given back in the early 1990s, late 80s, $1 billion worth of loans and money to have his songs and everything paid for and so forth. This guy was worth a fortune. He went to his grave owing $400 million. You see.
And he, of course, he'd moved towards the Nation of Islam somewhat.
Yes, and he said he did a song about hate me, kike me, always try to strike me, blah, blah. And this, he actually told him that he got fleeced by these people, got robbed blind by them.
Yep. He actually tried to speak out about it. The thing is, though, that as we were saying off air earlier today, these people have a cunning whereby they know the places to attack and infiltrate in order to take over something.
Yep.
So if they identify two or three weak points in the trust that Mr. Ford set up, you know, they'll make their first move. Somebody stood there. That person will then open the door to the second point, who will open the door to the third point. They then have a vote, change the articles of association for the trust, and it's a memorandum of association on what its key objectives and goals are. They re-vote all of that and then start diverting the money off to Holocaust memorial funds or whatever.
Well, and what we also see is that seed money has been used to set up very powerful fortunes, and we can see that in relation to Pierpont Morgan. When he dies, he's only worth $7 or $8 million, and control of $20 million, which was a pittance compared to the monies that he was supposedly in possession of. But through trust, that money went back to old Europe, which of course we know Rothschild was his seed money. But the same was true of Carnegie. and the steel interests and the people who built the railroads, which were the internet people of the 19th century. But we also see that happening today with internet billionaires, the Bezoses of the world and the and you know the Larry Ellisons of the world, where a lot of that money through through association and through control goes back to the original purveyors, and that's why they always end up in Jewish hands in the first instance, because they know darn well these people will not bite the hand that feeds them. And you know the gold industry, you take a look at it, it's very interesting. You know, I was looking at the when I was doing shows down in South Africa, which you've done a couple with me when I was on air down there, I looked at the holdings of Barrick and of Anglo Asante and some others, and some of their biggest gold companies. They all went back to the New York and London bankers. Their ownership did. 70-80% of the control of common stock, and then almost all of the preferred. So they were in the hands of the Jews from day one. Companies like Kinross, through different control mechanisms, completely own and operate this $30 billion gold company. They never allow anything of that size to go under the radar. And of course, you could see the manipulation politically, what they did to the country of Ecuador, robbing them blind of an asset that should have been paid out in huge sums of money, got paid out in pittance. And then I'll guarantee you, Correa, the president of Ecuador, was told, you complain about this share deal that we're doing right now what the heck was the name of the company there? The gold company, Aurelian, that they robbed. You say a word about this, you see, you know, you'll be planted in the ground within the hour of you making us angry. And of course, you people don't go up against them. We've got a mess on our hands, Muhammad, and we started talking about how we have to wrestle control away from these people in order to be successful at implementing the proper change needed. We know the change that's needed is there. We know there are solutions. We know that good people of good moral character are available. We also know that we can re-implement the concept of moral hazard into the process, where if you've gone and done the crime, then you've got to be there to do the time. Do you remember the show? I brought this up on another broadcast, but I'm going to ask you. You remember the show Beretta? The cop from America, he was a tough cop, and it was really, don't do the crime if you can't do the time. It was back in the late 1970s, early 80s, Muhammad. It was a great American cop show. Everybody loved it. Well, the idea of that whole concept of don't do the crime if you can't do the time is basically moral hazard.
Yeah.
You want to play with fire, and you get burned. You can't make somebody else take your burns for you.
Absolutely. I mean, this is one of the problems with the Zoharite mentality. There is no concept of moral hazard at all, because there is no concept of moral. Even with, as you were pointing out, Darrell, the problems that you find in the Sephardi group, who are adherents to the Talmud. The Talmud at least has some moral, in that, you know, you shouldn't kill other Jews, you shouldn't rob from other Jews, but you know, Gentiles are fair game. When you're playing with people who've got that moral view, and this is very important for people to understand, you know, there is a small group, both the Zoharites and the Talmudists, who actually don't subscribe to the morals that the rest of the people in the world do. And this is one of the reasons that they can't be allowed to manage or play any active part in the social order, because they actually really don't believe in social order, not in the way that we do. They believe they are the top of the social order, and that the rest of us are fair game. To steal from us is like stealing from chickens or from sheep or something. This is one of the problems, Darrell, that people don't understand. This isn't racism. We're asking people to look at the religious beliefs of these people to understand that they do not have a set of morals like the rest of us, which is why they're able to do these things.
It's described in modern day psychology as psychopaths.
Absolutely, they are sociopathic psychopaths. There is no doubt about that. For them to not be able to feel empathy with their victims is absolutely, totally psychopathic behavior by any textbook definition.
Well, and you can see the result of the psychopathy in the world with the Kaganovich going down into the Ukraine and confiscating all available food to the public in the richest growing region of Russia, and then starving 20, 30 million of them to death while at the same time having bumper crops for their foreign exchange. These kinds of psychopathic policies are now being implemented in the United States.
Well, the point is down that it is the mentality that's there. It's demonstrable as a part of what's held in their belief system, and that what's happened is that as their influence has grown more and more externally and overtly, I mean, let's not forget, people of America, how many dual passport holders there are now. How can you be part of the US administration and legislation and have dual loyalty? It makes no sense in any government that people should actually say, I'm a dual citizen and I'm actually part of the administration of this country, but I'm still loyal to another. It's absolutely insanity in itself, and I'm amazed that people are allowed to hold that position. But if we realize that all of these people were from the same part of Mongolia, that they were all Mongols, and 40% of the US Senate was people with dual Mongol nationality, people will be jumping up in the air about it and saying, how can you possibly be loyal to us? Or Chinese, how can you be loyal to us and China at the same time? No dog can have two masters. How can you possibly be serving us both? These people have corrupted the mindset of the Americans into that being an acceptable state of affairs to start with.
This whole discussion we've had tonight is kind of, again, a historic overview, but also a hopeful discussion, Mohammed, and it's drawing to an end here. The hopeful part of this is that we do have solutions. We have discussed them. In the next visit from you, I hope, we're going to get into some details about some ways of looking at the financial system that doesn't include these people at all. Now, of course, we have to start focusing on ridding ourselves of them. You know, the Irish have just taken the worst drubbing in the history of finance. I have never seen a nation acquiesce to these kinds of usury ever. I mean, come on. Can you imagine they owe a trillion, and there's 4.5 million of them, they owe a trillion?
Well, you know, Darrell, you know, all we can expect from the current system and its leadership is a mess. And as you say, Darrell, I mean, there are solutions out there. There are things that we can try. We can try and fail the first time. That doesn't matter. We can be trying, but there are solutions out there. And there is no doubt, absolutely no doubt, hand on heart, with these people out of the way, it could be a wonderful world with a lot less suffering and misery than we have at the moment, a much happier place with a much happier global population that can get along far better than it is doing today, and could be, I mean, there is no excuse for poverty anywhere in the world with the means of production that we have today, but a far better place and a far better future for the next generations to come if we can actually just get rid of these people.
Well, you know, it's a big job ahead of us, and I've always hoped that I would be here to see it. There is a growth within this message. There is a powerful expansion of who knows and who hears and who's seeing these things, even to the point where people, and you're starting to see the people who've been duped waking up. And there are a lot of people out there that I may have thought were working for them, and that they're actually coming on board honestly. There are others who you are absolutely seeing who have never been honest. Alex Jones is one of them, saying the other day that Hezbollah is setting up bases all along the Mexican border. This came out of his mouth two and a half weeks ago. This guy is an absolute a shill for the Zionists. But and he's just tipped his hand. But other people are actually coming around to the facts, and we see it through the numbers. You know, I don't take credit for having been able to put this stuff out. I take it as it's an honor for me to be able to do this, although it's very hard work. emotionally as well as financially in every way. It's very hard. But I have to say that my stick-to-itiveness is my responsibility, and I've done that pretty well through health problems and the rest of it, family issues, all kinds of stuff. The truth is that we all have to have the same kind of drive I've shown, at least in some level, at some level. I've been driven by this because I see the value for my children and my children's children and the future of humanity. And everyone else who's interested in helping in this regard has to also see the value and the urgency. Because if they don't, we won't succeed at defeating these people. You know, the jury's still out whether we're going to take these people down or not, because the control grid is definitely a powerful tool for these people, and they're putting it in place right now, Muhammad. You know, they've got flying drones, they've got you, they're going to be chipping your credit cards, your money system, your everything, and they're turning most of the men into women, and they're a bunch of foofs that can't even fight their way out of a paper bag. So who's going to be there to stand up when they've foofified everybody? I don't know if there's a word called foofified, but it seems to be apropos to what's happening to most men and that I see around me. They're a bunch of woofs. And I'm thinking to myself, you know, little by slowly, they're dwindling our store of righteous, hardworking warriors that we need to go out there and defeat these people with. And all this warrior stuff that I'm talking about is mostly on an intellectual level. But there are also warriors needed on the ground, people that are willing to carry out the spreading of this information through flyers, through rebroadcast, through making YouTube videos of these discussions we have. All of this stuff, that we need warriors out there. And you can be a warrior and still be a genteel in your affect. A warrior is a warrior in his heart, Muhammad.
Oh, absolutely, Darrell. Absolutely, and the thing here is that we're fighting, you know, it's certainly in the mental planes, we're fighting a war. I consider it to be very much a spiritual battle. For me, there is a spiritual dimension to it, in the sense that, you know, it's a people who've got innate morality, that understand innate morality, who are going up against people who have actually lost their morality. They were born with it. It was something that everybody is given by God when they're born, but based on the decisions they take in their life and the way they live their life, they destroy that morality. And we're basically now dealing with a global leadership which 80% of it doesn't have any morality at all, Darrell. And that for me is the spiritual side to it. And what we're hoping is that these people at the top who want to poison people from their own moralities below them, whether it's through foofifying them or, you know, whatever it is they're doing, emasculating them in one way or another, trying to change the way they behave, behavior modification. These people stand and say, I'm a free man and I've arrived at my own decisions, and I'm saying, you're a genetically modified organism, you've had your innate character changed, you've had your critical thinking skills destroyed, and you've got the arrogance to stand there and say you think you're a free thinker. These people really need liberating. I hope, Darrell, that they're not that far gone as the leadership are, that they still can't, you know, call a spade when they see one.
Well, more and more people are less fearful of the epithet of being called an anti-Semite, because they're understanding that Semitic often and more purely means Palestinian, not Jew. But more than that, they're starting to see the folly in these you know, claims being made by the rank and file Jewish community as being nonsensical in some instances. And now we've got this WikiLeaks nonsense out there that is you know, savaging all. And these, a lot of the documents are real, so we know that they came from an intelligence source. But they're being let out and leaked out in a way that is beneficial to the political aspirations of Israel within their region and Zionism globally. So, you know, Ki Bono, again, you got to look at the larger picture to understand who's doing this and who's benefiting from it. But it's all over the airwaves, and everybody's, you know, this guy Assange, which means a monkey, the monkey. Mr. Monkey Boy over there is basically either being used or is part of a conspiracy to help promote Zionist dogma and Zionist goals around the globe. So.
Well, there's no doubt the whole thing's been very carefully stage-managed. It's interesting that WikiLeaks has done a sweetheart deal with The Guardian newspaper.
Yes.
Initially, WikiLeaks put itself forward as a website whereby anybody who had information that they wanted to put out could go and post information up there and leak it. That was the concept. Of course, the latest set of leaks, large quantities of them, are not available on the website itself, and they've actually been doing deals with newspapers to release them and broadcast advantageous bits which look advantageous to the anti-Pakistan stance, which has been growing quite a bit recently. As a Pakistani general once said, it's more dangerous being an ally of the United States than an enemy. Pakistan stood by the Northern Alliance and the entire Afghan invasion and bent over backwards and forwards and any which way to make sure that the anti-Afghanistan war was a success and helped in every which way they could. Now that they've ended their usefulness, everybody's now saying that Pakistan is the biggest threat in the world to nuclear terrorism. Ignoring the fact that India is probably even more lax than Pakistan if you wanted to gain control of nuclear yellow cake or, for that matter, refined fuels. India is probably far easier to succeed than Pakistan, because Pakistan really desperately need their weapons. It's a numbers game in any potential war against India, so they're actually a lot more heavily clamped down than the Indians are. Indians just to hold some as a posture more than anything, I think, Darryl. But the bottom line is that all of this stuff which has been headlined is all anti-Pakistan stuff. And then they throw in the middle of it a little bit of, oh, some Americans thought that the British weren't doing that well in Helmand, and a couple of other bits and pieces just as sound bites. But it's all rubbish. There's nothing there that is really earth-shattering. I didn't see any of these people talking about what really went down on 9/11. I didn't see any of these people talking about what really went down on 7/7, which means that it's controlled content.
That's right.
We can be fairly sure, Darryl, that people in the intelligence services and in the diplomatic services know what the reality is, and they must discuss it regularly as we discuss it regularly here. But none of that stuff has made it out into the open, and that's proof that it's controlled.
Well, you know, Mohammed, I said to you earlier, the second largest city on my stats list is Washington, D.C. And the first largest is New York City, and the third largest is London. And so, you know, when the numbers come in, and there are, in a month's time, there are tens of thousands of hits from each one of these locations. And, of course, we have all around Virginia area, from Reston, Virginia, and the rest, all of the intelligence agencies, huge numbers coming from communities that only have 15,000 residents. So I know that they're hearing this stuff, and I'm wondering how much of this stuff is starting to hold sway within their thinking of the rank and file. You know, these compartmentalized people who, I bet they've even stopped allowing this compartmentalization of listening to the French Connection, because we might begin to convince some of the people who don't know the whole story of the story. They're going to get revolt within their ranks from listening to us.
I think they probably are. I think there's a lot of people using secret surf and ultra surf and these different surfing techniques at work to be able to access these things, or maybe going to internet cafes. The fact of the matter is, Darryl, well, you know, once a cucumber becomes a pickle, he's a pickle, and that's the end of it. He can never, you know, like they live, once you put the glasses on, you've seen what's going on. They can't go back. And the fact of the matter is, it then becomes just becomes a moral decision for them, and this is why we hope that they have sufficient morality within them to recognise that, yes, they've got to keep up to date with it, but also they need to move on this stuff ultimately.
Well, Mohammed, we've reached the end of the hour. I will make a recommendation for everyone in the world who's listening to my voice to watch They Live, a very powerful indictment of Zionism. And it's not spoken clearly, but make the parallels, make the connection, and you will be gobsmacked by watching Carpenter's movie about this. It's just really shocking. Rowdy Roddy Piper's in it. It's not a work of art in the acting area, but certainly on the political realm, it is absolutely unbelievable how accurate he parallels the control of these criminals over our lives. Really unbelievable. Anyway, Mohammed, I want to thank you for doing this. I know you've been under the weather. You feel a little better, and I know I grabbed you up as soon as I thought you were able to link two phrases into one sentence, you know, and do some thinking and processing here. I want to put you back on in about a week to move into some of the more finite questions on these things we're talking about. And I'd like you to, if you would, listen to Shakespeare's presentation coming up early next week, so we can actually add value to what he has to say, or tear it apart with critique, whatever it's going to take to kind of suss out some ideas from what we can do as solutions.
Okay, well, I've missed being on the show the last few weeks as well, Dale, so it has been good to be back, and thank you for having me back, and thank all the regular listeners and supporters out there for their listening and their support.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, until the next time, I wish you all well. We are having terrible weather here in France, snowstorms, blizzard, icy roads, it's just a mess here, and it's tonight is 6 degrees below 0 Celsius, which is a very chilly night in France. And a lot of car wrecks and stuff, and there's no sand and grit on my roads, ladies and gentlemen, so it's very tough moving in the countryside here. But until the next time, reach down and lift up those people around you you love, and even those people that you just know are good people at heart. Make sure they're protected in this fight, so we can bring them on as soldiers in the battle, ladies and gentlemen. Until next time, it's Darrell Bradford Smith telling you all, please, be well.